So it's been a minute since I've been on. I want to catch up with you guys and let you know what's going to be what I plan to get up to here on the channel. First off, in an effort to get better dialogue quality, I thought I ordered a lavalier mic and I got a Chris Gaines 9000 instead. So this is kind of funny today, but I'm going to get rid of this thing ASAP. Yeah, Happy New Year to everybody. What I'm going to be doing here in the coming weeks and what I plan to try to get to, because I know a lot of you guys want to see more drum-oriented stuff, I'm going to start using Eventbrite to generate some ticketed events, and hopefully you guys can help me sort through this, because I want to do a test run here. So what'll happen is I'll have a blast on my page or all my social media that'll have a link to where you can go get a free ticket. And I want to do maybe in the next week, I'll sit down and take some Q&A from the drums, go through some playing or whatever, and we'll test run this thing that way, where you basically get a link that will allow you to check in about 10 minutes before I announce that I'm going to go live. And we'll start doing these things that way, or some of them. I'll still do these live streams the way we've been doing them, although it's been like 6 weeks or something here. One of the first things I'm going to do, I want to do a trial run here. I'm going to do an entire overdub session for a friend of mine who writes some really cool tunes. He's agreed to allow the use of the music as an opportunity for you guys to watch me go through my process. So the idea will be, and it may be, it just you'll see exactly how I work. What my process is. So I'm going to do what I would normally do working for someone, but along the way I'm going to make a point out of every choice I'm making. We'll go through drums. I'll break down my whole miking setup and all those things. So that's going to be probably in a couple of weeks. I want to get this other... I want to get through the process of us using some of this back and forth with the Eventbrite event managing stuff for that. So, anyway, let's see who's going to show up here and have some questions. Hey, Yuki and Tobias. Hey, and thanks, Tobias. I used your picture here for the little announcement on Instagram yesterday. Again, anybody out there that wants to message me, Filippo, man, today, how are you, man? I'm good, thanks. Hope you are well too. You know, we're still here. Weird, strange times, but hey, what's up, Jordan? So yeah, for those of you, good grief, man, see, this is just. I have to laugh. Oh, this is not what I had in mind. I just want to make music. But I'd rather just hang out with you guys. I feel like I'm peddling some bullshit here. But anyway, hopefully, you know, guys, give me some feedback on, you know, how this mic is working. We're going to get into some deeper things upcoming as I can get to it. It's hard to maintain some momentum of doing this regularly. And again, like I mentioned, hey, Walter. Walter's on here, man. Walter Rodriguez. What's up, man? So I'm going to try to do a blend here of getting on interactively like this, just hanging out, and then some things that are more intuitive, which will at some point probably be a ticketed situation. But back to what I'm going to do maybe here in about 2 weeks, once we get through the process, if you guys help me out with this, we get it sorted out, because I don't want to broadcast something live, because the idea is as I'm doing some of these things, I'll take some questions You know, and trying to not let it really interrupt the process of how I typically work and approach recording. So it'll be a walkthrough of, you know, like I say, I'll start out, I'll take you around the kit, show you, you know, we'll listen to the song, and I'll explain to you what I decide to go for drum-wise, and then once we get to that, I'll go through tuning. It'll be an immersive thing, okay? So hopefully you guys are up for hanging out for a little while on that. So, but before I get to that, I need to do a couple of test runs just so that I know that everybody is familiar with how to use the online ticket and how to get in and out of the thing. So we'll do a few free things up front. I'll still do these impromptu hangs and so forth. But so yeah, I'm going to just check out some of these questions. All right, it says the sound is good. You know, it's funny about this thing. I looked for wireless. I'm not giving a plug here. I guess I am, but you get into wireless stuff, it gets really expensive. And again, I want a lavalier. I didn't mean to get the Chris Gaines XL, but I'll get that swapped out. But yeah, it's just gonna it's gonna free me up to move in and out of this room into the main room and not lose communication. And it was only $150, Samson. So it you know, they make pretty good stuff. I have a headphone amp that I use in sort of satellite situations, and I've recommended it to a couple of people. It's worked out well for them. So how do you keep heavy grooving up-tempo tunes? That's a good question, Yuki. How do you keep... I'm not big on up-tempo tunes, first off. I don't... I don't like playing fast. You know, I like... And I say that, but I want to be able to be, you know, in the conversation of any kind of music, but it's not my favorite thing, because just typically the faster the tempo, the less nuance to a groove there is, and it just becomes a different animal. So a lot of that comes down to physical conditioning. When we were out with Toto, probably the most up-tempo thing we did was maybe this song called Home of the Brave. It was a pretty long arrangement, but everything's different. Yeah, you know, the fills, everything gets doubled at higher tempos, so, you know, certain single-stroke fills don't make sense because they get too fast or whatever. So I'm always looking for maximum impact, you know, like how can I move the listener? And it comes back around to something that kind of came to me. It's just to what my general thought about music is, and I think most musicians that I really love. It's basically, I want you to feel in some form or fashion what I'm feeling about the music in that moment. So the things I try to play and my approach to playing is about really communicating on that level. And a lot of times, that's not about a lot of busy notes. It's about spacing notes out, maybe pulling against the time a certain way, inner dynamics to try to launch things and make things feel dramatic. And just the faster you get and the more you subdivide, the less nuance to those kind of things there is. And that's where kind of my medium that I like to play in, and I also like to hear other musicians play in, is somewhere in there where there's, you know, some range of deeper range of expression. Although up-tempo stuff and guys that can play crazy fast stuff is amazing too. And you can certainly make people feel something in all tempos, but... just typically, I like a groove, and the faster you get, it becomes a different thing. Let's see what else we got. Oh, the talkback mic. Okay, well, here we go. Somebody wants more talkback mic. There come 5 dB. Let's see how that is. Happy New Year to you, Niels. Man, you guys, you know, setting up this fan page for me, that's amazing. So let me know. You know, I'm pretty solitary guy, hang out here in my studio a lot, spend time with my kids and work on old cars, and you know, I don't get on to all the pages nearly enough, but I do enjoy this. It's funny, man, after a minute of getting away from it, I feel this real initial resistance to getting back and doing it, because it just is just not a natural thing, but I'm really happy to interact with you guys, so this is great. See, who's got a question about the question on the kits? You do hear a difference between a Gretsch USA custom versus Pearl Maple Gum kits looking to get either or. I can tell you absolutely with no hesitation, it is striking how close, how much Pearl nailed this particular sound they were going after. And I've had it here in my studio. Now, my drums, you know, the last kit I got was delivered on January 1st, you know, the first couple of weeks of January 2018 when we were starting rehearsals for the Toto tour that year. So I haven't gotten anything since then. Things can change. Manufacturing can change. I highly doubt that. So they are, without question, better. I have them side by side. I have had a couple of friends of mine right here with me. It's astonishing that you could have a drum like I compared it to a kit that I have that's 40 years old. So right in the kind of a golden era of that sound. And the signature, the imprint of the sound is, I mean, identical, except in certain areas the new drum that I have here was better, just more even resonance, and just probably just the general nature of components being in round and edges being, but I mean, it's, I go there, the hardware is way better, you know, if you're making a choice there. And like I say, my kit that I had on the Toto tour right here in my room, side by side, just might as well call it identical to my 81 Gretsch kit. So if you're asking what's what, there's that, you know. Who else we got? I got any other questions here? So, yeah, back to anybody just kind of getting on here. I'm going to be doing some clinic-style events, but it'll just be, you know, virtual audience, I guess, like this. And I'm going to step through over in the coming weeks. I'm going to just throw some things up where I'll do some little, you know, maybe Q&A, some demonstration things, talk drums from the drums, just to get all my tech kind of worked out here with you guys and make sure you guys are up to speed on how to get a ticket, which will be free at least initially. And it'll always, there'll be some variation on these things. If I get into a deep dive on something, then I'm going to treat it more like a public event. So, yeah, I'm going to go through a tracking situation where I'm going to take you guys right with me on a tune that I haven't heard. You'll listen down to it for the first time with me as I listen. And then I'll walk you through everything that I am thinking and doing, and you'll watch me cut the track, get sounds, you know, do the whole thing and get a look into that process for me. Let's see some other questions. Hey, Yolanda and Cody. And yeah, Yuki. Yeah, hit me with anybody on here, you know, just find my, you know, my other social media pages. And if you want to send a question, probably message me through Facebook Messenger is the easiest way, I would guess, you know. So find me on there. Let's see. Your kick drum in the verse, Hold the Line, is killer on the recent tours. How well do those dynamics come through the monitor when you have a crowd and everything else behind? Well, thanks, Keith, for that. On the bass drum, he's asking about Hold the Line, and that's an interesting thing for what it's worth. I'm real specific out live. I take my own mixer and I get a split from the lines coming in, so I everything comes into actually, I should give these guys a plug here. Mackie gave me a DLR 32 or DL32R in 2015, and I used it on every single tour for 5 years without a single failure, never having to be sent in. It traveled the world with me. Sounded better than the DigiDesk to me, you know. I mean, of course, no question about it, because I've got drum sounds on both. I dialed things up so that things sort of matched up for the rest of the guys on the Digi thing. And, yeah, that little Mackie thing is... And anybody that's doing their own gigs, of course, nobody's doing a gig now, but when we get back to reality, better reality, the DL32R, I think is what it is, and they have some updated version of it. I didn't even have to update because mine never stopped working and never gave me a problem. I still have it. And the next time I go out on tour, it'll be going back with me. But the point in the initial question was I have to be able to hear a bass drum. Basically, for me, I can, and I'm sure it's the same for everybody, when you're playing live and you don't hear well enough, even if I don't hear well enough in the studio, if I don't hear the bass drum, I mean, essentially I have to hear the kit balanced the way it's kind of balanced in the room. I'm playing to that. And if the kick drum's buried, I'm playing too hard from the beginning to balance it myself in my head. And then you can just waste your leg real quick. The interesting thing about Hold the Line, any groove like that, which is like Hot Fun in the Summertime or, you know, whatever, those are all downstrokes, right? As I've developed over the years, I play a lot of combinations of different things, heel down. Basically, I play farther down the footboard, about halfway in a lot of times, and that's, I've discovered, is more a tonal thing that I fell into as I started opening the drums up. Like, we went through this whole transition of having bass drums like really deadened down, and then everybody went to these boutique heads where everything's more open and they kind of sound like over EQ garbage to me, and I still use an Ambassador on tour. Just, you know, sometimes I'll make compromises with front of house because I want the best thing coming out the room for that situation, but I still tune and dampen it the same way regardless. And so got to turn my phone off. Lost the train of thought there. So that's all downstrokes, but getting the bass drum to kind of track and get more envelope, more shape of notes out of there is a big thing. And so in grooves like that, there's no combination. It's like double strokes and the molar technique and some of these things that are all based on bouncing and whatever, and there's guys that do amazing stuff with that. I toy around with it, and I've definitely used some things to develop some soft, light touch stuff for some things I do. But if my bass drum technique has always been a bit about sliding on the pedal and moving around on the pedal, and I kind of found, like I say, back to where my point was, is there's different tonalities up and down the footboard, and I ended up moving down the pedal without realizing I did it over the course of years because the biggest note that I could get out of the drum burying the beater was halfway down the footboard. I'm still burying it, but there's a lot more resonance in the note if you get all the way up against the stop and really hammer it. It chokes the head even more than just burying it, which, you know, you can go on and on. The discussion about that approach on bass drum is, you know, there's guys that play off the head. It's amazing. You know, there's just, but I'm the other, I bury the beater, you know. Hold the Line thing, it was something, I hadn't played that groove in a long time when we started touring. And I was doing some other things with my bass drum, just technique, and I realized that kind of thing, boom, 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 that all had to be all ball of my foot to get that to be immediate and play all three strokes. If you're doing some sort of heel, you know, heel toe or just sliding or using the, you know, just other techniques, then you get into three different strokes, and it's constantly, when you're in triplets, it's the same thing when you're playing Muller technique for triplet grooves. It's like, well, that thing's for the most part largely based on a rebound. Of course, there's all different strokes guys get out of it. But that's why sometimes when you hear a triplet groove with guys that play that way, it kind of sounds stilted because it's very odd. It needs to be downstrokes. And if we're talking drums for just a minute, you know, I mean, the hi-hat's a real specific thing to me, and my favorite drummers play the hi-hat in a very specific kind of way. And it's, there is some finger information always in there, but it's not bouncing and it's not double stroking. There's the guys that have the best intent with the hi-hat to me are, they're playing every note. There's nothing accidental and nothing is a rebound. It's like if I play an up-tempo shuffle, it is all downstrokes. I mean, the fingers are working in there, especially at certain tempos, but I'm still, I see a lot of guys play it, and they go, dit, and I'm going, well, whatever that is, that's just, that's going to, the articulation of that is going to be solely based on gravity, you know, physics, and that's not where it's at for me. It's every one of those notes has a very specific inner dynamic and timing, and you can't get that level of intent with a double stroke. Anyway, let's see what else we got here. My Pisces setup, Earl. So the last time out, one thing I love about my all my stuff from Pisces, I have five or six different setups of symbols right now. Lately, I've been back on the big beats, which are kind of like a variation of 2002, and I'm playing on the bigger side, like 19, 20, 21. But I'm also, you know, things got, all these cymbals got wacky to my ear with, because I also mix and do a lot of other things. It's these big trashy cymbals that sound like wash and air. It's like, that's fun. It sounds really cool with, if you don't have anything in your ears and you're just playing drums, sitting at the drums, try to get that, you know, audible through, you know, two electric guitars and a whole, and that was the same situation, live sound reinforcement as well. They're fun, you know, it's a novel idea, but it's kind of a novelty to me. Those cymbals, I mean, if you get that soft and dark, they just don't make much sound. So the last tour I was out, the 40 tours and that DVD and stuff, those were signature dark energy crashes, and it was 18, 19, and 20. So 18 would be my first crash on the left, and a 20, and a 19 on the right side. And I better plug my computer in. I didn't realize it's not plugged in. Oh, surely I brought that up here with me. Bear with me, guys. I don't seem to have my power supply. Well, we'll just see how far we go. And so the other cymbals were Modern Essential, 15-inch hi-hats, 22-inch Modern Essential, and 22-inch Modern Essential China. The Jake to the Bone, for example. The 10-inch snare, I had to use. Yeah, this is just, that's a Brady snare drum, and it's really his 10-inch snare drum versus any other. I haven't found another usable 10-inch snare drum for me. There's something about the wood he uses and how hard it is and just how it matches up to that drum. It's just sort of a special thing, and I have three of them now because they're scarce, and I bought all of them that I could find. All the ones I have are ply drums. So, yeah, let's see what else we got here. So, yeah, it's a Brady 5.5 by 10. Favorite bass player in Toto? Oh, man, you can't, you know, you get to a certain point with musicians, you know, where there's just a level, a room where you know, special, you know, really unique musicians that have their own voice reside, and I was lucky to play with several of those guys. You know, each guy had his own unique thing. You know, Hungate obviously is the original voice and intent of those early recordings in the band, and that was it. And Sklar, I mean, you can't really pick, man. It just it was something very special about all those guys. You know. Hello from Mexico, man. Thank you. Practice, man. My computer's going to die here on me, guys. I'll get back on tomorrow. We'll do some more of this stuff, all right? And we'll do another update. If I go dark here, surely I can't believe that I didn't bring my power supply up here. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to grab it. You guys bear with me for about 2 minutes, all right? And I'll be back, okay? Total informal time here. I'll be right back. Man. Wow. Okay. See, I was trying to just say how informal this is. It should hopefully be a no-pressure situation. That's funny. Good news is I was breathing heavily there for about a minute or so from running down to my house and back. So, practice. Somebody was asking me about practicing. And one simple thing I'll tell you that I do that helps, that I use to, that seems to help me center my just keep things clean. I do a lot of work with Swiss triplets because just the nature of what that is and changing which hand I'm leading with, I can really work the muscles, you know, that I want to get to, fingers and, man, can't learn gospel chops. Don't. Let me just say, how about this? How about this, Filippo? Don't learn gospel chops. I can show you a button on my drum machine that does it really well. So, anyway, no offense, but yeah, I don't like that. The mic sounds out of phase left, right. Well, I guess that could be on my, somewhere here, but I don't think that could be it's a mono feed off my console. Maybe. Oh man, you were right on. Dang. I'm just, you know, you gotta give me a little bit here getting back to this, okay? That probably fixed it. Let me know, Tom, if it did. So, yeah. Well, you know, maybe we a do-over here, right? Because everything, we're just now kind of getting everything sorted out. But, yeah, back to the practice thing. Swiss triplet is a good one for me if I were going to say one thing that I do. I play things when I'm practicing. I try to play sort of open phrasing where I'm working on my brain's ability to play sort of an endless string of variations of phrases without stumbling, and I do that as a mental exercise just to kind of keep that part of me sharp. And then I'll do a lot of, like I say, it's the Swiss triplet thing is really great for building evenly. I can lead with one hand or the other, and then I do what I was saying is I'll play. I don't play a lot of double bass drum stuff, but I do work on it, and I'll play single strokes against that Swiss triplet, and I'll just switch which foot I'm leading with, and that's a good exercise for me on multiple levels, just physically. And there's something about making, if I lead with my left hand and I voice it on say the hi-hat and snare drum, and I play the first like if I was playing a shuffle out of my left hand, right, with my right hand, and then the bass drum is I'll lead with my left foot and just play even triplets under all that. I mean, by the time I get that real precise and articulate and loud, it's a good physical exercise, and it's a good exercise for just centering, you know, your limbs and keeping everything real clean and tight. So I, that's one thing I've been doing a lot lately. Mighty, you never use splash cymbals. Basically, it's just the context of the music has changed a lot, and I look at what I put I set up as voices for the track, and more times than not, they're smaller little accents, and it's just not they're kind of light just in general. So a lot of times they don't really have the impact. I do like them, and I actually have wanted to incorporate some of that. I love watching I was watching some old video of Manu playing in the early 90s, and he had his setup in such a way. It was just great what he was doing with them. There's so many people, Vinny, Stuart Copeland. I mean, it goes on and on and on. But all the same, sounds the same. Well, maybe it's not. Maybe it's you, Tom. I'm going to record it and listen back and find out. Not a big deal. Well, you know what, man? It could be just. I recorded and played back some of this talk back mic earlier, and it was fine coming back off the console. We'll see. We'll see. I'll get to the. Like I say, I'm working out these. This is all kind of. You guys are my guinea pigs, unfortunately, to. That was probably. Insensitive to say, sorry. You guys are my test group that I'm going to work out some of this technical stuff on. So anyway, whatever. A stick warm-up routine. I'll do these things. Man, you guys that have some of these questions, let's do this the next time I come on here. I'll do it from the drums because now I'm testing this remotely. Tom, I'll figure out this thing with the audio. I just rebooted the thing. I could be something with the wireless maybe getting worse. I'm gonna move this to here because it's not so far. I haven't found it to be the greatest. Maybe you get what you pay for. We'll see if that fixes it. All right, it's a little hotter now. Well, that maybe may have been some of it. In the future streams, can you cover how you come up with your interpretations of certain sure. Leo, yeah, let's when I'm out at the drums, you know, the next time I'll just take a Q&A there. That's what we'll do next, all right? So yeah, anybody that's just getting on, and I know this thing is getting long, most people are not going to come through back and watch all this, but just reiterating, I'm trying to get some cohesiveness between all these social media things, and I really kind of hate the whole concept in general, but I'm typically using Instagram to kind of announce, which may be not the best way to do it. If somebody has a better idea, hit me with it. If you go, once you're at my YouTube page, if you're here, just make sure you've hit notifications and subscribe, and that way you'll get an update. But basically, I'm usually blasting somewhere on my Facebook. The upcoming, what I'm doing. I started reading a text from Monica. Hey, Monica. I hope you are well. Still doing okay over here. I haven't worked with Joe Vanna in quite a while, but I know he just released a new project, so I hope you guys check that out. Thanks, Jonathan, on the live stream. Tom's asking me about drum tuning. That's another one I'm going to do, okay? But for better or worse, I'm going to treat these like clinics, some of these things. But what I will do is go way more in depth and spend way more time. And then once you're in on the way this thing's going to work, if I do a ticketed event for something like that, you will have a link to the video. It will not be a public video. Anyone who purchases the ticket will have a link, and you can go back to that link and watch that anytime. So essentially, it would be like making an interactive, if you will, video on how I tune my drums that you can then go back and reference all you want. And I'm going to try to do it that way rather than do it through a third party where we make a video release and all this stuff. I just want to try to keep some of these things that are like a deeper dive into what I do more direct line to you guys. And then, if we pick up some momentum and I want to do it another way, I'll do it that way. But that's going to be the idea, Tom. So in the coming weeks, I'm going to do things. I'm going to do one where I break down a shuffle, and I'm going to take you guys through all these permutations of what the nuance to my ear of the hi-hat is. Just, we'll just start doing a regular thing. And some of this, if you guys hit me on social media with some things that you want to know about, interested through it. Let's see. Yeah, tuning, it's a funny thing because I watched a really great video with a producer, engineer, genius cat named Eric Valentine. I'll just say this. I have a way that I've always done things sort of my own understanding. And by the time I get the drum making the best sound I can get out of it, it's typically the same net result as what other guys do. I just kind of get there a little different way. Somebody's asking about click. Would you use any click modifications for sounds? Well, if you're talking about like metronome click sounds, I gave up on what I used because engineers became fairly militant about wanting to be on the grid from the time they were recording. Which was always kind of baffling to me because all you got to do is type the tempo in and drag this little marker over to the downbeat of my count off and it's on the grid, but whatever. So I stopped using my own sound, and I had a sound that I had used for decades that came out of a Roland sample library that was, for me, it was just the right amount of length to the note. Like if you have a click track, it needs to be specific enough that it's kind of telling everyone where the middle of the note is, not giving too much length to it to make it too much room for interpretation. It just depends on, what we're using the click for. At this point, people just, they quantize things to the point where they don't even understand what they're doing, and it's not doing what they think they're doing. So I use, out of Pro Tools, I just open up their click, and I use what is Cowbell 1 preset, and I put a low-pass filter at 3K to knock the top point off of it. And essentially, I've learned to play with that. I don't like it so much because what it does, when you play to those things constantly, that there's left, as short of a click as I used, what I used to use this little maraca sound with a low-pass filter on it, and I could basically get it to where when you were playing with it, you couldn't hear it. You only really heard it if you were getting all away from it, which was the kind of what I wanted. So I could set it at a level where I'm hearing it, and then once I'm playing it and I know I'm centering the time where I want, it's gone. But it was also long enough that I could lay the backbeat where I wanted, and you just didn't start to hear audible flam. You know, when you're playing to a click, like Pro Tools like that, what you end up doing is, for me, and so that I don't hear a flam on my backbeat, because you're not going to hear that flam with the click track on your bass drum because the envelope of the note is bigger. What ends up happening is I typically, it's very funny because I've just been working with an old, like a Akai MPC 60 and the resolution of its clock and how accurate it could get, because it could only get so accurate, and it was kind of like that was the beauty of it, because once we start getting into these infinitesimal levels of subdivision, it's really kind of defeating the point. But back to my point, what I end up doing is when I play with the click, my bass drum ends up kind of laying, visibly looks like it's laying ahead, because the note doesn't fully arrive at the zero crossing of a waveform. So I'm playing my bass drum to the point where the tick of the click is, you know, I'm not hearing a flam there, but I'm laying the backbeat where I want to, which is right on it, because I don't want to be hearing a constant flam there. So the bass drum ends up being about 10 milliseconds visually ahead of the click, because internally, I typically, my backbeat is about 10 milliseconds later, depending on the tempo, than the downbeat, which is sort of, you know, a thing, which if you quantize stuff, you're killing that thing. And what's really funny about it is I spent the last couple of weeks working with the drum machine, and I used to always, when I played to an MPC 60, I would always shift anything that was playing on 2 and 4 with my backbeat later by two divisions of what the MPC 60 would do. And I did the math on it, because it's a 96 points pulse per quarter note clock. And it's at 120, the tune. It's like, oh, well, you know what? At 120 beats per minute, if I two divisions on its clock later, is 10 milliseconds, which is funny to me, because that's what I've always kind of felt like that internal spacing was. It's proportional as you go down in tempo and up and whatever. But so anyway, that's a long dissertation on the click track. I would love to see the miking part of the kit. Yeah, I'll do that. And the mixing as well. So basically, when I do this next thing that I was mentioning in a couple weeks here, when I track these drums thing, I'm going to go through the whole process with you. But this will be like a ticketed online clinic type event. I'm not going to crush you guys with the, it'll be a cheap ticket, but still, it'll be something like that set up. And, you know, prepare to make time, because it could be a 3-hour event, you know. I'll make sure that if you guys purchase a ticket to go in on this thing, then you'll see everything I do, and I'll give you a description of, you know, kind of why, and take some feedback as we're going. And we'll see how it works. You know, that's just kind of been an idea of mine. Opinion on Simon Phillips' technique, personality. I've never been lucky enough to meet Simon Phillips, but he is virtuoso, amazing musician, and like all drummers that I respect, they're musicians beyond just the drums. You know, it's about what level of musician you are, and the drums happen to be your voice. And Simon has a unique voice. I mean, you know, when you get guys out there, and there's a lot of it's a great point that you bring up, because if you're going to say you can hear people's influences, but you know, when a guy their voice still comes through loud and clear. Obviously, if I have to guess, I'm thinking Simon Phillips is a big Billy Cobham fan at some point, and I don't know the history there. But for all of this commonality there in those two guys playing, they come out with two distinctly unique personalities and voices within that. So yeah, Simon's great. I would love to meet him, love to chat with him. But yeah, just deep respect. He's amazing. Got his own thing. Got his own sound. Hey, dig it. So that's the idea. I'm probably going to hang here for just another couple minutes. Do you, do I do sports besides drumming? Tobias. I love sports. I was an athlete through high school. I gave most of that stuff up because I was already starting to play sessions, so I wasn't able to play team sports for the school and stuff because I was skipping school to play sessions, and I couldn't skip practice. Baseball and basketball, and I love to throw the football. I just never liked getting tackled, so I didn't play a whole lot of football. But I every day here for the last month or so, I'm out throwing football with my boys in the yard. We play a lot of basketball. Big time sports. I'm a huge Laker fan. Been a Laker fan since '86. First time I turned on professional basketball, the TV heated up to Magic Johnson on the fast break. So, you know, if that's your first exposure was Magic Johnson on a fast break, you're probably going to be a fan for life, which I was. So yeah, I love sports. I'm a big Tom Brady fan. We'll see what happens with the football going forward here next week. Baseball. I grew up in a little town called Easley, South Carolina, and it was 2 hours from Atlanta, and cable first came on, and so Turner, TBS had the Braves game, so I was a Braves fan and still am. If you worked on Luke's, Joe's records, no, I didn't. I worked with David some, Pates some. He and I still are working together. Awesome. I'm glad you guys. So yeah, keep your head up. I'm gonna use. Hopefully, I'll get Pearl and Peisty and some folks involved in getting the message out. But I want to do a few test runs with you guys. Next time I get on, I'll go out to the drums. We'll make sure all our audio is working well. That I'm getting feedback from you guys. The thing's working real fluidly. My talk back from this to the room out there, is consistent, and we'll get all this stuff knocked out, make sure the stream's not dropping, make sure everybody's able to get in with their ticket the way. So we'll do these free tickets, for the next few times we do stuff. And that way, once we pull, go into some real stuff, we'll have some familiarity with the process. And then the one back beyond that, I have my own band that was was the real heading for me musically before Toto and all that stuff. It was really all I wanted to do was have my own rock band and put a lot of time and energy into it, and it ultimately kind of fell a little bit short. But I have some really great music hanging around, and I'm going to dive back into one of the tunes in particular, and that's going to be a series of clinic type things where I'm going to, you'll be able to watch the process, because this is me making a record, so it's going to be my full production hat. I own the music, so I don't have to worry about it. A lot of times I would love to show you guys the ins and outs of what I do, but I just can't, on unpublished and unreleased music, it's difficult to have anything in the room live. But some of my stuff that belongs to me, I'm going to use that as a means for us to do some of these things together. And I, Filippo, yeah, I love Italy. I love Europe. I love all the beautiful countries over there. The people, just the cultures. It's just that's the biggest thing I'm missing from touring, and. One of the best things about touring with Toto was the fact that a big part of the larger part of their fan base really was in Europe. So we spent a lot of time there, and it was just great. I love Europe. I love traveling through Europe, and I love all the people over there. some Yuki's asking about. Yeah, I mean, my body's shot, Yuki. I mean, you know, it's and I have it in my elbows, shoulders. I have arthritis. I have some hereditary arthritis problems too. I mean, there's different things we could talk about, you know, and I can demonstrate, you know, maybe when we're out at the drums. You know, the drum's a physical instrument, and, you know, for better or worse, your posture and body language and what you're giving up when you're moving, how much motion and different things, it comes through the other side of the instrument. And if you're some of these things that may be better technique-wise, they change the sound, they change the impact of the note. Then, for better or worse, I play the way I play. I continue to try to improve certain things, but I'm going to play the way I play and hit the way I hit until I can't play anymore, but I imagine I'll be all right, you know. In regards to drums, are you mainly using the compression on your SSL console, or do you have outboard API? Yeah. I'm tired of the sound of compression, you know. It's like so much of the playing and things, there's a lot that happens with compression, and depending on the part, you can get one sound out of the loud note, the big full back nut beat, but that amount of compression that gets that sound starts to change the inner dynamics. Like when I'm playing a groove that has ghost notes in it, changing the internal dynamics and inner relationship of the volume of those notes. I'm playing that absolutely on purpose. So if it's going to be there, I want to record through it so that I account for that change in compression as I'm playing. The specific question on my console, what I like for drums, a few things. I use the channel compressor, which there's a lot of emulations for if you're working in the box. I don't pull the fast release switch out on them. I'm about 3-1, about 9 o'clock on the release. And I pull the threshold until I get the first yellow LED starting to hit. And there's a lot of variance in that first LED on the compressor. So you can hear it start to work when it just starts coming on. And you can hear it work a ton when it's not even getting into the second LED. So it's sort of a feel thing. And I tend to like it on the lighter side. Same thing on my bass drum. Bass drum, you know, limiting on the bass drum tends to eat low end, so it tends to compact everything together, but it also kind of, if you want the big warm bottom end on it, you need a FET limiter or something like that that will pass low end better. And then I sub all of my drums down through two channels on the SSL where I have an API 2500. That is typically what I like, which is a little, I don't hit it very hard. And then if I'm just dealing with a dense track that's kind of modern and heavy-handed, the channel compressor on the stereo channels on the SSL is very aggressive sounding, and I do the same thing with it. Basically, the first LED, which is indicating 3 dB, but it's there's a lot of nuance inside that first light, gets a really super aggressive, heavy-hitting drum sound, and it's not much more than that. I have two 1178s, which are awesome sounding on overheads and rooms. So it's simple, you know, Yuri 1178 or 1176 style for my overheads and rooms. I like the faster, just more pop impact sound of these channel compressors, which is actually a DBX variation, which I also like DBX 160 VUs and 160Xs. You know, it's all kind of answering to something that's familiar to our ears, you know. So, tips for increasing speed on tom fills. Yeah. Single stroke stuff. I mean, you know, I see guys that can do amazing stuff, single strokes. There's, you know, if you build up too much resistance trying to play to a certain volume, you choke your muscles out and you can't play is fast. Again, I just kind of think fast is, it has momentary value, but I'm not, especially when you're playing live, for one thing. If you're in a big room, you have all this echoing, delay, slapping around, even in a club. If the sound reinforcement isn't enough, all fast stuff just sounds like a blur. And it's like frustrating because it's like, oh, I'm playing all this inside shit. Nobody can tell. You can see my hands moving, but you can't hear it. You know, that's why, you know, obviously playing single stroke stuff around the toms is going to speak. Yeah, you have to ask somebody else on increasing speed around the toms. I think there's no getting around. You just have to start slow and work it up. Single stroke stuff, but, you know, work it up, work it up on the snare drum, work it up on one instrument on a pad or whatever, and then start spreading it around the kit and see what you can do with it. I tend to like to add the bass drum inside the fills, which is the guys I like that do that. It's like Steve Gadd and Jim Keltner, and they're in certain settings, will break up a fill with a bass drum, one note inside a bass drum, and it creates a real sneaky turn in the phrase, and it can still help articulate a faster phrase. I just like turning a phrase. When you get into a whole bunch of single strokes around toms, there's only going to be so much to the phrase. It's going to be one long run of something. Although, I mean, Gary Husband does some really awesome stuff with how he does single stroke stuff. So go check out Gary. There's some wicked things he does with single strokes. So, yeah, what else we got here? Oh, favorite tune to play. Challenging tune to play with Toto. Somebody had sent me a link to something we were... there was a song called Great Expectations, and it wasn't so much that it was any one particular thing that was difficult about it. It was just a challenge because there were so many movements within the arrangement, some time signature things, some tricks here and there. I really enjoyed playing Jake to the Bone just because it was an instrumental thing where, there's long sections where we're going to get into some room to stretch out and get off the page and do things different from night to night. Whereas for the main body of the stuff, I tried to keep it within a certain context, the arrangement of things. But let's see what other questions we got. What about your preferred preamps for drums? Preferred preamps for drums, API, you know, if I have to have one pre on everything, it would be an API. I'm not a huge Neve fan. The center frequency of a Neve preamp is just a little higher on the low end than where I want to feel it building up on drums. But the Neve thing is great too. But yeah, it's all expensive, you know. I have these Portico series Neve stuff, which is very, very much like a 1272. Very similar in what it does, and they get close enough to that for me. There's no way I will ever spend $10,000 for a Neve 1073. It is the most overvalued, overrated. One of the most overrated at this point. They're great, but they're not worth $10,000 a channel, if you ask me. Favorite snare? There's a... It's hard to say. I have a late 60s chrome over steel Ludwig that probably, if I just had to have one drum, I'd stick with that. But I have a few drums that function that well, too. Now, I have this prototype drum from Chris Brady that's a ply drum that was a, what do they call those? It was a called it a baritone snare. And it has almost all the mass cut out from it. He made them in block drums, but he never mass-produced the ply drums because they're too fragile. And that drum is sort of uniquely, it can do kind of anything. It sort of defies logic of what it is. And, Yuki, the snare on the video clip you asked about is a 6.5 maple, pearl maple sensitone. It's crazy how good that those drums are, the 5 and the 6.5. But that what you were asking about is the pearl maple sensitone 6.5. Stupid good drum, and I think about $300 off the shelf. So can't go wrong. I used those on one tour, a good bit. It might have been 2017. Pretty sure it was 2017. I used the maple sensitones. And so yeah, I'm probably gonna jump off here. Let me jump back in tomorrow. Favorite Michael McDonald tune to play. Gosh, I'm trying to think in the context, you know, because we made that record together, and I played some gigs with him. I keep forgetting is always a fun one. Anything with that kind of Jeff Porcaro hi-hat groove is always going to be a fun one. Minute by Minute was always a fun one just because it's such a great triplet groove to be able to play again. Back to that, that's another one we could list when they were asking about Hold the Line and Hot Fun in the Summertime, things like that where the bass drum pattern is sort of all downstrokes to get it to feel the way I want it to anyway. So, yeah. Man, I appreciate all you guys showing up. And again, we're going to build this thing up over the next couple of weeks. So I'm not going to I've had a big absence here in the last couple of months, just winding the year down, dealing with holidays and stuff like that. But concerted effort here to get on because I have some things I want to do and share with you guys. So thanks for being here. Keep a head up on my notifications and hope you guys all have a groovy day. All right. Thanks for coming, and love to all you guys.